The opinions expressed by individuals and guests do not necessarily reflect those of WRGN Rain Radio ATL or Sound Feast Media LLC. And I don't know if you'll ever hear me, but I got salt in my wounds from the tears that resulted. Every hurt shows we're mortal.
Hey, what's happening?
Brother, what's up?
This is a deep recording, man.
Yeah, brother, like, dig it.
Solid, right on. What's up, hey, man, what's your name?
Sweet Dennis.
Welcome to The Word on the Streets with JP. I'm your host, JP, and you're not going to want to miss today's Sound Feast in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
You can't stop. Can't stop, won't stop. Where the brakes at? I give him that ditty bop. Like, take that, take that, take that.
Welcome to another episode of Word on the Street with JP. I'm your host, JP, and we have a power pack, as usual. Show for you lined up today. We're going to be talking about iniquity, and it's funny because the last show that we did talked about iniquity, but we just kind of gave the initial definition of iniquity. I had planned on doing a show back to back, but the Holy Spirit arrested me and kind of inspired me to go a little deeper into what iniquity is. And so that's what we're gonna do today. Yeah, so I'm excited to have you here listening to me, watching me today. I believe that this is Holy Ghost inspired, reason being, well, I always think that it's Holy Ghost inspired, but I think that this message is particularly important to God in regards to the body of Christ and how we treat one another. It's one thing to expect the world to deal with us in ways that aren't pleasing to God, but when it happens in the walls of the church, in the body of Christ, in the family of faith, I think it's more hurtful, not only to us, but hurtful to God, because it shows that we haven't grabbed onto the foundational tenet of our faith, which is love for God, number one, and then secondary, love for another, which is just as important, living in this earth suit and experiencing all that we experience down here on the earth. So I'm gonna start off, I usually start off by praying in, but I'm not inspired to do that. I just wanna give the message, and I'm excited to give the information that the Holy Spirit opened up to me as I waited. I thought I was procrastinating, you know, but during that time of what I thought was procrastination, God was actually preparing a message in the ground of my heart. And so in order not to act in place of the Holy Ghost, I went right to the Word, because, you know, especially when you have a vehicle in order to reach the masses, a lot of times we will act as if we are the Holy Ghost, and we will tell about things that happen to us, but I'm not inspired to do that. It's just going to be unadulterated what the church body is doing to each other and how we're treating each other in such an egregious manner. So in a previous show, we talked about iniquity, of course, and what it is. And as I prepared, man, just a whole lot more nuggets came to surface in regards to how we treat each other. And I was inspired to give a particular message today. So in order not to ramble, okay. So I've got a whole lot of notes. I'm going to try to abide by them, but should the Holy Spirit direct me and take me in another direction, then that's what I'm going to do. But so I'll start off by saying the Holy Spirit arrested me and urged me to go deeper in the area of iniquity relating to the church and the level of damage that iniquity is capable of. It's a very, very effective tool of the enemy operating in the church. So most of us put sin, iniquity, and transgression into the same pot, assuming that they are synonymous with one another, or they mean essentially the same thing, but they don't. It couldn't be further from the truth. Iniquity is something that God has put special emphasis on in regards to what we shouldn't do, not only as we deal with those in the world, but especially as we deal with those in the church. So we'll define sin, we'll define iniquity, and we'll define transgression and the differences that they are towards one another, how different they are towards one another. Sin refers to moral failure. Sin is just doing something without love, period. You know, anything that you do without love leads to sin. I'm not saying that it is sin, but it leads to sin. And it's a moral failure. Transgression is descriptive of how we break trust with one another. And so iniquity plays a big part in bringing about transgression. So, and then of course, there is iniquity, the big I. It's derived from the Hebrew word avon, or how we would say it in English, Avon, as in Max Factor Avon kind of thing. Anyway, so avon. And avon comes from the root word ava, which is also Hebrew, which means to be bent or crooked. So in essence, it's saying an iniquity is a crooked way, a distorted way of dealing with one another. And it's commonplace in the church, it's commonplace in the world, it's commonplace in the marketplace, commonplace on your job, commonplace in your family. And it's just a bent, crooked, distorted way of handling another person. And we do it all the time. So I'm gonna give you a nice example. So you got a kid, it's his first year of college. You know, you paid for him to be there. He got the financial aid, he got the Pell Grants, he got all that stuff. So now he's there, he's living on campus, and he finds that he's short for books. So he calls you, he says, "Hey Pop," this is my kid, "Hey Pop, I'm about $300 short on getting the rest of my books for this next term. Can you hook a brother up? Can you hook a sister up?" And so you send them the money, and then something else happens, and they call and they ask you, "Hey man, hey Pop, I'm short. And so you send them some more money. So they realize that, hey, shoot, when I call home, brother man, Pop gonna send me some money. So you start taking that kindness for weakness, and you start working an iniquity. So spring break is coming and you want to go, but you don't have the funds. The child doesn't have the funds. So they devise a story. This is iniquitous. They devise a story. "Hey Pop, it's an emergency. Call me back. And they blow you up like you owe them some money. And so you finally call them back. "I'm so happy you called, Pop. My transmission is slipping, man. And I got this internship that's way across town, and my class ends here, and then I gotta be at my internship at this particular time, and if the car fails, man, I'm gonna get a failing grade. And so son, how much, daughter, how much are you gonna need to get your transmission looked at, and if needs be, fixed?" "Oh, I'm guessing about $600. So you send $600. "Hi, hey, Pop came through again. In essence, you funded his spring break, because there was nothing wrong with that car. That's iniquity. And iniquity is something that continues to happen. We do it in very small ways all the time. Ask somebody for something for a particular purpose when what you're asking for won't be used for that purpose. That's iniquity. How we handle, it's a good example, excuse me, of iniquity. And so it happens all the time. And the crazy thing about it, the sad thing about it, is that it's commonplace even in the church. So iniquity is such an assault on the ways and the will of God that its consequences is visited on the fathers, not only to the third generation, but down to the fourth generation, according to Exodus 34, verses 6 and 7, and Deuteronomy chapter 5, verses 8 through 10. So he mentions it twice in books that are right next to each other. So iniquity has been around for a long, long time. It's been the bane of fellowship in church for a long time. Iniquity has been there since the beginning. In essence, iniquity is ingrained in the church as a whole, in regards to dealing with those, the members of the church, and it's considered to be the way it is, or even normal. But that shouldn't be the way we do things in the family of faith, in the body of Christ, in the church as a whole, as believers. We determine that iniquity is the egregious and unfair way we treat one another, but it's so much more. It is actually considered willful sin. It's a premeditated way of putting somebody together in order to get what you want, and it's not cool. Sin with premeditation and motive is essentially what iniquity is. It is so damaging because it carries a weighty consequence on both the iniquitous abuser and the victim, you know. And so I'll give an example. I already gave an example. So Jesus came to take on our avant, or our iniquity. He took responsibility for our iniquity at the cross of Calvary. He took that thing, he bore it for us, he died with it, he delivered it to hell. And so we should, by grace, be able to not operate in that fashion. So again, the tenet, the cornerstone of our faith is love. And if we're concentrating on the love aspect towards one another, we'll have a less of a propensity to act out an iniquity to our brother or sister that's trusting us as a believer to do the right thing regarding the situation or circumstance that we find ourselves in together. So etymology suggests that the word is Hebrew. It's a Hebrew derivation, is avant, which literally means crooked, perverse, i.e. evil regarded as that which is not straight or upright or morally distorted. That's a more descriptive definition, just for your notes. Iniquity is the main reason why not only just new believers, but believers become church hurt, and they leave the church. They don't necessarily leave the family of faith, but they'll leave the fellowship that they were called to by God, and that is not a cool thing. It's a very effective tool of the enemy, used to minimize the prospect of unity in the body of Christ. And so if ever you find a brother or a sister that doesn't go to church anymore, I can bet my bottom dollar that someone was iniquitous to them in the church, or maybe they were iniquitous to members of the fellowship and were run off. You never know. So iniquity is damaging not only to the one who is engaged in such an egregious way of treating people, but the people that are also deemed to be victims. Okay, so iniquity can often be found in those who look like they are truly devoted to the things of God, but are found to be busy about doing good works in and for the church, but all with an ulterior motive. Man, I can't tell you how many ministries I've run across that look great on the surface. It's like a cupcake with your favorite frosting, and then when you bite into that thing is just as bland as, you know. So it's the same thing. And that's the reason that God makes plain the consequences of those who employ this most evil and deceptive practice in Matthew, the 7th chapter, 19, verse 19 through 23. And it says, everyone that brings not forth good fruit will be hewn down and cast into the fire. Verse 20, wherefore by their fruits shall be known. Not everyone that says unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that does the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name? And in your name have we not cast out devils? And in your name done many wonderful works? And then will I confess unto them, saith the Lord, I never knew you. Depart from me, you that work iniquity. Now that's pretty strong. So remember that word, iniquity. So much more than sin, so much more than a transgression, but it's that egregious way that we treat one another in a premeditative manner in order to gain upper hand. So this is a very short message today. I just felt like I'm starting to see it more and more in the ministries that I deal with, and how people are busy in the ministry doing the work, but without a pure heart towards the people. Many work in the church to gain upper hand in business or the prospects of many other things, but it's never in regards to iniquity. It's never for the sole purpose of just blessing another, just to bless them. It's really sad, and the Bible says in the end times, just like I said in a previous show, because iniquity abounds, that means it's prevalent, it's almost normal, commonplace, it's everywhere. And Paul, in this particular scripture, was talking about the church, the body of believers, and they weren't that far from have seeing Christ walk the earth, and they continued, and they knew the power of Christ and the Holy Ghost and of our faith, and they continued to walk in iniquity. Because iniquity abounds, the love of many, and so we can't take that lightly. When it says the love of many, that means a whole lot of folks. The love of many shall wax cold. Yeah. So, you know, I was getting ready to say this before, but I've walked into many a church door. I remember, wow. Ooh, Lord, I'm not going to say that. But I remember at a particular ministry, I'm not going to make it about myself, but I remember at a particular ministry where one particular brother came in, and he was known for being homeless, and he was known for, and this was a big ministry, with plenty of resources. He was known for abusing drugs, sleeping on the streets. And so he was obviously lost. And he came to a point in his life where he knew that he had to change, or he was going to die out there in the streets. And I live in Atlanta, and some parts of Atlanta, and this particular part of Atlanta was very, very rough. And so I had to commend this guy just for surviving as long as he did out there. And this was a few years ago, and he came into the lobby of the church, and instead of panhandling, he sat and he listened to the message. He listened to the message, and then he got a hold of one of the ushers, who was so rude to him. I was embarrassed for the guy, and he didn't ask for any food, and he didn't ask for any money, but he asked, is there anyone here that could help me? And I guess the person that he asked assumed that this guy was going to start begging or be a beggar. And they kicked him out of the church. I'll never forget that. Just against the whole foundational tenet of our faith. the love aspect. So iniquity in regards to that, somebody did try to help him, but they helped him by putting him in a program that was bleeding cash from donors, and it was just to satisfy their numbers. And so when I caught back up with this fellow maybe a few months later, he had finally gotten himself together, but not with the help of that ministry. And that was so sad for me, because that ministry was very well able to accommodate this guy. Instead, he said that they took advantage of him, and they had money to rectify his particular situation in regards to homelessness and abuse of illegal substances, but they didn't approach it that way. They just added him to the numbers in order to increase their probability of getting funded for that program. So that is the perfect example of dead works. And so, like we just stated in the word, you know, on that day, God will say, everyone that says to me, Lord, Lord, will not make it or not inherit the kingdom of heaven. And then they'll tell God all of the great things that they done in his name. And then he'll say, I ain't even hearing this from you. Just go away, you worker of iniquity. Not go away, you sinner, or go away, you that transgress, but you continually work iniquity as a way of dealing with people. So that's my sermonette for today. In order not to belabor things, I'll go ahead and sign off. If you've heard anything that you can identify with, then we need to pray against it. We need to set up a standard against it through prayer. For the prayers of the righteous avail much. And if Christ is coming back for a church without spot nor blemish, when are we going to start working on the church in order to get it in position for his return? I'm just saying. So, in case you're just tuning in, you're listening and watching Word on the Street with JP, I'm your host, JP. And so if you heard anything that you dig, or anything that you can relate to, I would be glad to take on your comments. You can go to Rain Radio ATL on YouTube. Rain as in R-E-I-G-N, as in He Reigns. Rain Radio ATL on YouTube. And hit the subscribe button. Subscribe. I'd love to have communion with like-minded people so we can get into this word and get some answers, because it's imperative for our survival as we operate in this world, number one. And number two, I'm not to fall short when the glorious day comes and he cracks that sky, and I don't want to be standing before him and he says, get away from me, for I never knew you, because you work iniquity. Just don't want to be that guy. So anyway, thank you for watching and listening to Word on the Street with JP. I'm your host, JP. Until next time, be blessed, be a blessing, and we'll see you, that's right, on the radio.